The concept is proven in a number of microprojects. So we decided to extend our loop antenna dimensioning tool for PCB antennas. It seems to have the potential to become kind of a classic, because many of our viewers are interested in the antenna principle that I first introduced about a year ago. In the meantime, I shared a number of videos where I analyzed, measured and tuned the antennas. I recommend these because there were a lot of new insights given. Some time ago, I presented an Excel dimensioning tool with which I designed the antenna for 2.4 GHz, 866 MHz and 435 MHz myself. The cracks among my viewers have no problem building it. With a little skill, you can make the antenna yourself for the frequency range 145 MHz to 1 GHz out of copper pipe or thick copper wire and also tune it. At higher frequencies, say 1 GHz to 10 GHz, we obviously have smaller dimensions and it is no longer so easy to maintain the tolerances. This motivated me for both to improve the replicability of my DIY suggestions as well as to define a tuning procedure. We saw in the last videos that a planar structure has some advantages for the loop antenna, and of course I didn't give up on my goal of designing a PCB antenna. However, with a planar structure you cannot change the diameter of the antenna for tuning. That's why we needed to improve the accuracy of the dimensioning tool in this respect. Let's take a quick look where the old Excel dimensioning tool still has weaknesses. We look at the diameters of the antennas for different frequencies, which I dimensioned using an earlier version of the Excel tool. The wire antennas are showing that the diameter needs to be a few percent larger than calculated. Keeping the wire a little longer, I could correct it before finally soldering the loop. You can't do that with planar antennas because the diameter is fixed and cannot be changed. In this column, I'm showing the deviations between the calculation and the actual values for the diameter and the center frequency. I then calculated the relative deviation between theory and experiment for each build. The deviation for wire antennas is around 6%. With the larger 70 cm ham radio loop, we have 2.8% deviation only, which gives us a good indication of what is causing the shift in the center frequency. The two-wire waveguide in the antenna matching network is reducing the effective diameter. The smaller the distance between the wires is, relative to the diameter, the smaller this effect becomes. The differences in the geometry of my tested antennas are suggesting this. With planar antennas, the deviation between theory and experiment is significantly larger than with wire antennas. The conductive bands for the loops are relatively wide, namely 20 mm with a diameter of 110 mm. The electrical currents certainly flow over the entire surface of the conductor, but not equally distributed. If we assume that for a moment, then the outer diameter should be 110 mm plus 20 mm equals 130 mm. However, this is not the result of our correction calculation. Instead, it results in approximately 121 mm. The currents on the wide conductor are obviously kind of pushed into the outer area. Interesting, isn't it? I put these relationships into formulas and improved the calculations for the outer diameter of the wire antenna and the planar antenna accordingly. Now it gets difficult again, at least for me, because now comes the calculation of the PCB loop antenna. The permittivity, also known as the dielectric constant of a material, changes the property of the antenna, especially in the feed area. This means that we have to extend the calculation of the characteristic impedance of our quarter wavelength transformer so that the thickness and the permittivity of the substrate on which the two conductors are located are taken into account. That was actually a bit difficult because you can't find suitable formulas on the internet for this case. This is probably simply because they are a bit complicated and I had to go through a number of books on high frequency technology to find them. And the formula for this would fill several pages here, and therefore I'm just citing the reference. But the good news for you is the formulas are now implemented in the Excel tool. We can now actually dimension the PCB antenna. And now we are testing this for a Wi-Fi frequency. I will briefly show again how the synthesis of the antenna works. We take 2450 MHz. Then I select a conductor width of 8 mm. I use 4.3 as the permittivity of the material, which is a usual value for good material. PCB material can have a permittivity between 3.5 and 5.5, depending on the quality and purpose. For higher frequencies, quality material with lower dielectric constant is usually used. By the way, I have a tip for you for high quality PCBs. Take a look at PCBWay's website. It is really the easy way. The company is offering PCB solutions for virtually every purpose, including high frequency. And you get a lot of additional information in this context. Okay, now comes the actual synthesis with the Excel tool. Of course, we let the computer do the hard work. We start the solver and define that our cost function below should become zero. And we define here the variables that we want to vary, namely the slot width and the angle alpha. The computer then varies thousands of combinations of variables until it finds the best solution. Apparently, there is a good solution here. The antenna matching is perfect, the slot width is within a feasible range, and the angle alpha is okay. We can now basically calculate three different types of our loop antenna with our Excel tool. Here I'm comparing the results for 2450 MHz. As mentioned, the calculation model is improved for the first two types. And the PCB antenna is added. I hope the tool will help you with your own projects. I will be setting up the PCB antenna in an upcoming episode, and of course I will be measuring it too. Now stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.